Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wildberger. Today's talk is the speed of light. C is not a universal constant. This is certainly going to be butting up against a lot of entrenched sociology in the physics community. But I hope that you'll be able to look at it objectively and apply logic and common sense and sort of a historical understanding of the story of special relativity. So the story of special relativity, in my view, needs to be rethought. It's actually much more subtle and problematic than is usually acknowledged. Even many professional physics commentators make what I believe are pretty serious errors in their expositions of this topic. There are important implications for cosmology also, because I think that subject could use more special relativity thinking in augmenting the general relativity that they currently use. So mostly we're talking about Einstein's second postulate of special relativity, which these days is something like that the speed of light is a universal constant. It's the same whatever reference, inertial reference frame you measure it in. And its value is this number C, which is 299,792,458 meters per second. Curiously, as of 1983, this is not actually an approximate value, but an exact one. Although prior to 1983, it was only an approximate value. We're going to have to talk about that. Okay, so light travels certainly very fast, at least by our earthbound standards. It takes light about 8 minutes to get from the sun to us. In 1 second, it would circumnavigate the earth 7 or 8 times. And for millennia, the question of whether or not light traveled instantaneously was actually undecided. Okay? Galileo Galilei was one of the first to try to empirically determine the speed of light using lights on nearby hills, but he was not able to come to a decisive conclusion. Ole Rømer in 1676 made the first astronomical calculation for the speed of light using Jupiter's moon Io, which had been discovered earlier, in fact, by Galileo, along with Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto. And Rømer observed that the time between its eclipses varied depending on Earth's distance to Jupiter, and was able to use this to estimate that in our units, C, the speed of light, was approximately 220 million meters per second. In 1849, Fizeau used a toothed wheel to determine the time for light to travel to a mirror and back, and this experiment was improved upon by various people, including Foucault in 1962, and then by Albert Michelson in 1879 and 1926. So modern techniques involve lasers in vacuums, and also indirect calculations based on wavelengths and frequency measurements, since speed is the product of the two. However, it is fair to say, I believe, that none of these experiments has honestly established a reliable one-way measurement of light. As the definition of speed, traditionally and logically, requires. Instead, these experiments involve two-way measurements involving a there and back reading, so they contain implicit assumptions about the relation between a going there speed and a coming back speed. This difficulty was encapsulated in the famous experiment of Michelson and Morley in 1887, which tried to confirm that light was an electromagnetic wave in a background ether, ether being an invisible medium in space through which light was presumed to propagate. The existence of this ether was a major assumption in physics at the time, in light of Maxwell's equations for electromagnetism. Michelson and Morley had a large limestone block which was free to rotate on a pool of mercury in the basement of a building in Cleveland, Ohio, and on it they had a beam of light which was split into two, and then after roughly traveling equal arms to two mirrors, reflected back to an interferometer, which then visibly manifested an interference pattern. Now, since the wavelength of visible light is around 1/1000th of a millimeter, the arms were not precisely enough calibrated to ensure that light would take equal times to pass along both arms. That was beyond them. But what they did was observe the interference pattern visually and then slowly rotate the limestone block. If there was a significant discrepancy between the speed of light in the direction of the Earth's motion through the ether and the transversal direction, then That would be observed once the setup had rotated a quarter turn. However, they detected no significant change in the interference pattern, no matter what the orientation of the block. This is one of the most famous null experiments in physics. It led to the rejection of the ether and was a key motivator, in fact, for Einstein with his 1905 Special Theory of Relativity. It is sometimes asserted that the Michelson-Morley experiment proves that the speed of light is the same for all inertial observers, but that is not correct. First of all, the experiment did not even measure the speed of light. In any case, it could only make an assertion about the relative speeds in transverse directions here on planet Earth. Michelson and Morley say absolutely nothing about what the result of a speed of light measurement would be on a Klingon warship zooming by at warp 8. For Einstein, the statement that the speed of light is constant for all inertial observers was a postulate or assumption. He used it to derive the Lorentz transformations that relate position and time measurements between two different inertial observers and that had been introduced and studied earlier by Lorentz and Poincaré. His first postulate, of course, was that the laws of physics were the same in all inertial reference frames. It is now taken as gospel that Einstein's second postulate is indeed correct. The physics community had become so overly confident about this statement that in 1983, during the 17th General Conference on Weights and Measures, the official definition of a meter was changed from being essentially the length of a standard particular platinum-iridium alloy bar kept near Paris to something dependent on the speed of light, as this was deemed to be more universal than a particular physical artifact. So the meter is now defined as the length traveled in vacuum by light in 1 over 299,792,458 of a second. And a second? Well, that was defined officially in 1967 by the 13th General Conference on Weights and Measures to be the duration of 9,192,631,770 periods of the transition radiation between two hyperfine levels of the cesium-133 atom. So now both time and length units were based on supposedly universal physical definitions. There is, however, a very big difference between the time convention and the length convention. So while physicists and engineers have been able to electronically count these hyperfine cesium transitions and use them to build extremely accurate atomic clocks, I know of no corresponding technology that uses the speed of light to manufacture extremely accurate rulers. So this modern meter definition seems to me a fiction based on an essential misunderstanding. The second postulate of Einstein is, in my view, either wrong or meaningless. The current definition of a meter in terms of it is seriously problematic. All those fundamental equations of physics in which the speed of light c plays a role need to be reconsidered. The number 299,792,458 plays no essential part in the story of the universe. Even the concept of that number of meters per second has no hope of being universal, since meters and seconds themselves are not universal. But the real problem is that of the underlying concept of speed or velocity to begin with. These are, sadly, not terms with any universal meaning. But to really understand that, we have to go back to the true founder of the principle of relativity. So the starting point is really Galileo, who clearly asserted that the laws of physics are the same for all inertial observers, as long as they're moving uniformly with respect to each other. Okay, so here is this beautiful quote of Galileo where special relativity is really born. It's in a book called The Dialogues Concerning Two New Sciences in 1638. Okay, so shut yourself up, with some friend in the main cabin below decks on some large ship and have with you there some flies, butterflies, and other small flying animals. Have a large bowl of water with some fish in it. Hang up a bottle that empties drop by drop into a wide vessel beneath it. With the ship standing still, observe carefully how the little animals fly with equal speed to all sides of the cabin. The fish swim indifferently in all directions. The drops fall into the vessel beneath, and in throwing something to your friend, you need throw it no more strongly in one direction than another, the distances being equal. Jumping with your feet together, you pass equal spaces in every direction. When you have observed all these things carefully, though there is no doubt that when the ship is standing still, everything must happen in this way, have the ship proceed with any speed you like, so long as the motion is uniform and not fluctuating this way and that. You will discover not the least change in all the effects named, nor could you tell from any of them whether the ship was moving or standing still. That's so important. Every student of physics probably ought to be forced to memorize that paragraph. And this is something that we all have experience with, because we've all been in trains or even in cars or planes. And we know that, you know, things do not start behaving really in a crazy fashion just because you're in a train, as long as the train is moving uniformly. Now, sometimes modern physicists will say, yes, but Galileo, yes, he had an idea in this direction, but not as fully as Einstein did, because Einstein was also incorporating electromagnetism. Well, I'm sorry, but, you know, if you're talking about fish swimming back and forth in a tank and birds flitting around and then jumping this way and that way, throwing balls, that has a lot of electromagnetic content, because our bodies biologically are driven by, you know, electromagnetic impulses. It's all electromagnetism at some level. Okay, so although he may not have understood what electromagnetism is in the same sense as we do, but he's still casting a wide enough net that he's basically saying, you know, all of physics is the same in any kind of inertial reference frame. So in particular, we're not able to tell whether we are at rest or not. Okay, so in particular, we cannot determine what the absolute velocity or speed of any other object moving uniformly with respect to us is. Galileo states this very explicitly. And the logical immediate consequence is that the concept of an absolute velocity is a meaningless one. So, sure, we can talk about your velocity or your speed as measured using my apparatus and units, but we cannot talk meaningfully about your velocity, nor indeed about the velocity of any object traveling uniformly in our observable world. So this has some unsettling consequences, but they're really controversial. First of all, there is no meaningful notion of here. Or to put it another way, the notion of a point in space is meaningless. If we could consistently identify a particular point in space, then we could establish that an object positioned at that point does indeed have an absolute speed of zero, which we cannot do. And it turns out that once we introduce notions of signals for observation and communication and make a certain assumption about the way those signals operate, then it will follow that there is a sort of a dual impossibility, that of having a meaningful notion of now, or to put it another way, that the notion of a point in time is meaningless. So this is very different from the Newtonian mechanics, which postulates a fixed space and a fixed time. So it's a direct consequence of Galileo's principle that these are concepts which are not really inherently part of the reality of the world. So it follows that the really meaningful entities are things that we could label as events. They're combinations of the form here and now. Individually, here doesn't make sense. Individually, now doesn't make sense, at least universally. But here and now, the event of a supernova, of star A, B, C, D in galaxy X, Y, Z, is something that far-flung distant observers can agree on. Yes, that actually happened. There was such an event. The event is meaningful, but the position and the time of that event are strictly speaking, not. These are only local concepts that can be introduced locally by particular observers. So we see that the space-time introduced by Minkowski to explain Einstein's special relativity is really a logical consequence, mostly, of thinking about what it is possible to talk about in a world in which Galileo's principle holds. So it's useful to modernize Galileo's ships and suppose instead that you and a Klingon scientist are both in separate inertial spaceships, drifting, or perhaps hurtling, or perhaps reversing through space. Let's say millions of light years from the nearest stars. You both may well be able to make measurements of each other's ships and determine relative velocities and speeds. You in your familiar meters per second, the Klingon with their perhaps familiar doodahs per quib. But how do you convert doodahs to meters or quibs to seconds? We are not allowed to suppose that the spaceships can accelerate and decelerate so that a docking and onboard inspection of each other's clocks and rulers is possible. This is outside the realm of special relativity, which is concerned with how measurements of inertial observers compare. So in many physics texts and videos, it's magically assumed that other spaceships are happily equipped with the same second clocks and meter rulers that we happen to have. How very convenient. Implicit here is the very big and totally unwarranted assumption that we are able to somehow manufacture identical clocks and rulers at some place and then distribute them over far distances and large times, involving considerable accelerations and decelerations. With the result, these clocks and rulers are still the same. This is the basis for the belief that physicists have that even distant spaceships will measure the speed of light and get the same answer. So, to summarize, nothing has an intrinsic speed. It is not possible to make a serious, precise measurement of the speed of light, in quotes, according to the definition of speed, namely distance traveled over time. It is not within the theory to meaningfully and universally compare the units used for distant measurements, clocks, rulers, for different inertial observers. That is, the statement that a Klingon doodah ruler is actually the same as an Earthling 1.57 meter ruler is false in special relativity and indeed meaningless. The real content of the statement of Einstein's second postulate, and I think the thing that physicists are looking towards and you know what they're really trying to get at, is a kind of special relativity parallel postulate. So in my next lecture, I'm going to lay out a little bit of space-time or time-space, and we'll be able to talk about these concepts in a more diagrammatic fashion, which I hope will clarify these issues here. Okay, but this is a very important topic, and it's interesting to, you know, to talk about the sociology of how these things end up entrenched, how we end up with the entire physics community agreeing that the definition of the meter, which is a fundamental unit for all of us, is going to just be arbitrarily assigned in terms of some fraction of a second, making this big assumption of the speed of light, an unwarranted assumption. I'm Nolan Wobbler. Thanks for listening.